ამლექსის მთავარი თემა იქნება კორეის ეკონომიკური განვითარება. ბატონი სულ ისაუბრებს იმ გამოწვევების შესახებ, რომელიც ჰქონდა კორეას 1950 წლიდან დაწყებული. გარდა ამისა, საუბარი იქნება ეგრეთ წოდებული იმპორტის ჩანაცვლების პოლიტიკაზე, რაც არის სახელმწიფოს ეკონომიკური ჩარევის ერთ-ერთი მთავარი ბერკეტი და რომელსაც ხშირად მოიხსენიებენ როგორც კორეული განვითარების ერთ-ერთ უმნიშვნელოვანეს წინაპირობას. და ასევე საუბარი იქნება გაცილებით უფრო მნიშვნელოვან რამეზე, ეს არის 2000 წლებიდან მოქმედი თავისუფალი ვაჭრობის სისტემა. და მე დარწმუნებული ვარ, რომ ეს ლექცია განსაკუთრებით თავისუფალი უნივერსიტეტის სტუდენტებისთვის იქნება ძალიან საინტერესო.
Can you hear me? Oh, thank you very much. Okay. As just warmly introduced by George the Georgian, Mr. George the Georgian, and also the Dean of Institute of Asia and the Africa, and I really thank you for your attendance. And also, thank you for your attendance late this afternoon. My lecture will be as long as a few hours. Okay, because the PowerPoint slide actually extends to 50, 60 slides, but I can actually condense to roughly 50-something minutes. And then after that, I'll try to take the questions from the floor. And then, if possible, I'll try to provide my own perspective and answers to your questions. We actually flew in with the Korea Foundation team on Friday evening. So we had actually a chance to travel around the near Tbilisi, about 80 or 90 kilometers, northwestwards. So we had actually visited the Gori, and I think where the Stalin, Mr. Stalin, was actually born there. Okay, but not only just looking at the museum and his birthplace, but also that I had actually a chance to look at the shanty houses in the rural area. That particular picture has reminded me of my youthhood, because I was born in the early 1960s, and back then in Korea, the city as well as the countryside was as rugged as your countryside. I think Tbilisi nowadays is extremely well off, I guess, compared with the Korea in 50, 60 years ago. So I think that there is a great kind of lessons the Georgians can actually learn from my special lecture. Okay. And upon arriving this university, I have realized two important aspects of learning. Number one, the free university is going to amalgamate with another university, I think agricultural university. Two universities will become one by the year of 2018, I guess. Subject to the ministry's approval and so forth. All the technical and the legal matters just resolved in due course. And the second aspect that I've realized is that the thing just a few people, I thought, I should deliver my lecture in Korean rather than in English, because quite a number of people, they expressed their great interest in Korean language and perhaps the Korean soft power, like a K-pop, K-drama, and so forth. But finally, I decided to deliver my lecture in English, okay? So just bear with me my poor English, all right? I've been to this university, Gaemyeong University, which is located in the third largest city in Korea, okay? With a population size about 2.5 million slightly, I think twice as big as that of Tbilisi population. And the college that I'm dean of is at Gaemyeong Adams College. Adams is coming from one of our founders, which is the North Presbyterian Missionaries. Okay. Well, so students, we are recruiting about 70 students each year under the two disciplines. And the students are learning top to bottom, just entirely in English, as most of you are actually doing here. So I will welcome you to my university whenever you feel like visiting Korea, and especially my university. As you are seeing here, my lecture title is actually The Success of a Korean Economy. There are many people are actually talking about the success factors behind the Korean economy. But instead of highlighting each factors, how they actually functioned and such, my lecture will actually just highlight on the evolutionary path of a Korean international trade policies. Because depending upon each decade and circumstances or the environment within which Korea actually lied in, the Korean government took different kind of a strategic response to the external and internal environmental changes, the economic side and the political side too. So I will go through kind of a process, okay, and then we'll come into so-called the post-Asian financial crisis period that actually earmarked great changes in the Korean economy policy makings and also social changes. And then I will cast some picture on the bilateral relationship between Korea and Georgia, okay, which was slightly disappointing, actually, and to which you can make a lot of a contribution. Okay, I'll just start up and throw out certain questions for you there. In my lecture, I will make frequently to the reference to what the Professor Kim has made in his lecture, because his political kind of arena in terms of a policy recent and the past has a certain, you know, ramifications for my lecture as well. So as he mentioned, on August 15 this year, Korea has celebrated its 70th independence of Korea, Japan, which was Korea's former colonial, you know, rulers. When we're actually celebrating 70th anniversary, Korea's National Statistical Office, or Statistics Korea, has released very interesting statistics, as you are seeing on this particular slide. Okay. The population surpassed the 50 million kind of a, you know, mark. And sometime in the April, to my recollection of my memory, I read this one specifically, it has been reported. And the GDP, you know what the GDP stands for, right? So I don't need to repeat it, okay? In current prices, in Korean, you know, the currency denomination is 1,485 point something trillion won. Okay? And the GDP per capita was just slightly less than 30 billion Korean won. And if you are born in Korea, you expect to live like as long as almost 82 years, okay? Georgia, 76 years on average. Ladies, you can live up to 80 something, and the male, because of heart, you know, chain smoking, they're dying early. Okay. Something like the 72, something like that. In terms of internet usage, about 84% of Koreans are actually considered to be the internet users. And if you're looking at the export of merchandise, it has surpassed the what is it, almost $500 billion, more than $500 billion, and import is also more than $500 billion. And on the road, you can see number of cars actually registered, the vehicles, over 20 million cars. Okay. With these numbers, actually you can, if you're looking at kind of a statistics as well, in 2014, the last year's figure, Korea is considered to be the seventh largest trading economy in the world. Okay. I'm using official International Monetary Fund World Economic Outlook database, so there is no kind of hypes at all. And in terms of a GDP size, Korea is considered to be the 13th largest economy in the world in the 2014. But depending upon the exchange rate movement, it actually changes the ranking depending upon which year you're actually calculating as. And in terms of internet penetration with 84%, I was really disappointed. I thought that Korea could not, you know, come to number one. But officially, we are considered to be 13th highest internet penetration ratios. And in terms of a population size, about 50 million, okay? And the 27th largest country, I think Georgia has a slightly less than 5 million, about one-tenth of that of Korea, right? And in terms of the GDP per capita, Korea is 31st richest economy in the world, okay? There are some statistics. in order to verify what I'm saying was not necessarily wrong or inaccurate. Okay, so you're looking at GDP, the Korea ranked 13th, okay, and the GDP per capita, Korea number 31st, and then so forth. And the figures on the first slide also indicate that Korea's GDP in 2014 is actually 31,000 times larger than the Korea's GDP in 1953. Not the 31,000%, it's a 31,000 times. Okay? And in terms of the GDP per capita, it was 424 times larger, the same figure in 1953. The export, 22,000 times. And the import, 1,400 slightly less times than 1956 figure, and so forth. But looking at this kind of a figure, you may think Korea is pretty well endowed with many things. Okay. But if you're looking at the Korea in terms of a territorial size, Korea is actually not as small as Georgia. But we are bigger than Georgia in terms of land size, because our land, you know, land mass is slightly over 100,000 square kilometers. Some figures indicate it's slightly less than 100,000 square kilometers. And on the contrary, Georgia is 69,700 square kilometers. So we are slightly 140% bigger than that of Georgia, I guess the official statistics. In terms of the land suitable for agricultural production, the Korea's land, only less than 18% of land is suitable for agricultural production. I think Georgia is something like 35-36%, something like that. Okay? And Korea is not well endowed with natural resources at all, except just the steaming coal, just a few kinds of the steaming coal. Other than that, almost no natural resource, mineral resources at all. As indicated by, as you are looking at here, about 96% of Korea's total energy consumption is coming from import sources. The coals, and the petroleum, and the uranium, and so forth. Okay? Because of a small size and with a big population, Korea is a highly dense, the country population. Density is about 500 per square kilometers. So if you have a chance to fly in Korea by air, perhaps you will see lots of high-rise apartment buildings as the most preferred types of residence, even though it is, we were told, it's a legacy of Soviet Russia. Okay, it's a sort of a collective housing. But most often, the apartment, big apartment blocks are actually much more expensive than the house with the gardens, which is quite contrary to ordinary people's expectations. And also, Professor Kim has mentioned about sort of geopolitics, okay, surrounding Korean Peninsula. We are still confronting with a very hostile North Korean, DPRK, official name is Democratic People's Republic of Korea. Okay? And that has initiated the Korean War, which has lasted over more than 3 years. Even though it has been considered to be short-lived, but nevertheless, it was extremely bloody kind of a war. Okay? As you actually seeing here, over 2.8 million people were reported dead, injured, or the missing, okay, from both South Korea and North Korean side. And the one outcome of this Korean War was the destruction of all the production capacities and the infrastructures. As you are looking at the statistics here, about 42% of Korea's manufacturing facility has been demolished, and about 60% of North Korea's. Because I'm ignorant of how the North Koreans are doing, so I'm not going to touch up on the North Korean side. Okay? In addition to the hostility arising from North Korea, and also we are surrounded by the major superpowers. As Professor Kim has mentioned, the four big whales. We are just a little fish, or the little shrimp, okay? That he said a shrimp, okay? So on the far right-hand side, as you are looking at here, the USA across the data line, across the Pacific. On the north side, it's Russia, okay? And the, of course, China, the second largest economy, okay? And Japan, always friendly but very hostile country, okay? Close neighbor, but remote kind of, very remote friend, I believe that. So if you're just traveling the Western world, you will come across, you know, the Georgia where your country is. But so Korea is always considered to be the melting point of a big whales on this particular far eastern corner. I think in that regard, that's why you're actually learning as a part of your international relations studies. Far East is one of your majors, dealing with perhaps Japan, China, Korea, and so forth. Okay, so you have come to the right lecture today, this evening. Okay, and because of Korea's economic success, okay, and many the organizations or the people actually have called Korea's economic success as the miracle on Han River. On the Han River. Han River is a Hangang, which actually flows through the capital city Seoul and the second longest river in Korea. Okay. More recently, the Times actually said it, the Korea's economic success is the Asia's latest miracle. Miracle is that it doesn't happen often, right? It happens, but it happens very rarely. So they call it a miracle. But considering all the fact, the status quo of the Korean economy now, compared with 1953, right after the Korean War, I think it is quite natural, even if you are not an economist in international economics or international economic development theories, how could actually Korea do it? I think that's a big question. They have a nothing. They had a nothing. But how could they do it? Become seventh largest trading economy, 13th largest economy, and so forth, from almost scratch. How do they do it? I think, so in order to answer to that question, I've actually drawn the kind of a statistics from the Statistics Korea 1953 to the 2014, okay? And as you are seeing here, there are the, what is it, dividing lines for six different, you know, timelines. And as you are looking at the bottom, red, you know, arrowed one, there are two big, you know, the era, okay? Pre-1997 and versus post-1997, okay? And I will highlight certain aspects in the Korean international trade policy changes after that, okay? So in Korea, pre-1960s is considered to be preparation stage because it has a nothing. You really have to think about it, okay, because you are becoming scholars or the students of international relations, and you will become the scholars in international relations. The country over which you have a certain interest has a nothing. How could it actually, that economy will grow? Okay, that's the question, and that you are considered to develop kind of a strategy. So be ready to have that kind of a mentality so that you can understand my lecture. Okay. So pre-1960, we considered to be after liberation from, you know, Japanese colonizations and so forth, so Korean War and kind of things. Okay. So post-Korean War period to the 1960, the Korean economy managed to grow by over 5% per annum. It's actually not too bad. Looking at small markets, I think back then the Korea's, South Korea's population was something like 26 million, that mark. But Korea's national policy goal, priority was always unifying Korea. Since 636, when the Silla dynasty has actually unified the Korean peninsula, remained as one country until it has become came under Japanese colonization and liberation. Right after liberation, Korea has split into two parts, North Korea and South Korea. Okay? So because of our historical, you know, background, spanning over almost 1,500 years, we need to be unified, reunified, not unified, reunified. So that was the national policy goal. No matter what you do, always the politicians were talking about that particular side. But as you are looking at Korean economy has managed to grow. They had nothing. Then what could be the source of economic growth? The money coming from other countries. We call it a foreign aid, especially from United States. During that particular time period, Korean economy market was very poor, and the most of necessities, nowadays economics terms actually call it, primitive necessities were we actually had to import from overseas. In order for you to be able to import from overseas, you need the money. Right? That money has come from the United States in terms of a foreign aid. So the Korean government start looking at slightly different perspective. Let's just start producing those primitive necessities and a substitute for the importables. So we call it this strategy behind the Korean economic growth in the pre-1960s period is called it's industrialization because we didn't have enough land to cultivate or produce agricultural product. So not the agriculture-based economic growth, it's a purely industrialization. Because we had nothing to export, almost, so we had to look at the domestic market. It is called inward-looking. Okay? And the basic strategy was import substitution. So industrialized, inward-looking industrialization based on import substitution policies. So it has backed Korean economies, and it's the 5% annual economic growth rate in this particular period. So statistics are actually readily available. This statistic actually coming from the World Bank, so don't worry about it, okay, see? In the 1960s, when the Korean market has become saturated through the first stage import substitutions, Korean economy was ready to take off. So we call it 1960s in Korea, we call it the takeoff period. I might just unbuckle my watch so that I can monitor my timelines. Okay. I happen to read a little bit about your Roosevelt Revolution in 2003. And a similar kind of a revolution by students actually has taken place in Korea on April 19th. We call it the 419 student revolution. And that particular revolution has toppled the existing government, and the Korean society and the politics and economy was utterly unmeasured. And someone has came into power through the military coup, the father of the incumbent president. He was Major General Park Chung-hee. So when he actually came into his office and has become the president of Korea, he dedicated himself to Korea's economic development. The history and the historians say assess his achievement in many different perspectives, economics versus politics and democracy side. But because I'm an economist, I purely just abide by economic side. He was committed to making Korean economy grow, simple. And one of his first strategy has been announced in terms of first five-year economic development plan. Okay? Starting from 1962 to 1966. And also after 1966, in 1967, he has announced the second five-year economic development plan. Unlike your country's 2020 socio-economic reform agenda, no, he actually said every 5 years. The political leaders in Korea, they always announce the 5 years kind of a plan. It's the medium term, and you can actually make people see where you're actually heading, rather than very remote, far away, there is a beacon in the kind of darkness. No, they actually use the 5 years economic plan. The main growth strategy that has been adopted by the President Park was outward-looking, still industrialization, But because the domestic market has been already saturated, they had to look at the market overseas. So outward looking. And to overseas market, you have to sell something. So export promotion strategy. Okay, what can you sell? You didn't have anything but very primitive technology and the highly intensive with the populations, which has a minimum education. They have a literacy. So they could actually follow simple instructions given by the any manufacturer. So Korean government decide to promote export highly labor-intensive manufacturing products. Because I was born in this particular period, I actually remembered my kind of a very early childhood. I actually collected lots of things. And the one recollection of my memory says that I think they were a kind of a hawker, you know, the hawker is selling certain stuff and collecting certain stuff. That man was actually shouting and said, I want to buy ladies' long hair. Hair, you know? I have noticed a lot of you have a long hairs, considered to be beautiful, something, something. But back then, there were actually hawkers calling out, ladies, we actually buying your hairs, something, something. He actually, the ladies, actually they cut their short, their hairs, because they need the money to support their lives. And with that, they bought the hairs, the Korean manufacturers, wig manufacturers, actually made the wig and export overseas. When I was a little and the primary school kid, the school principals actually has asked the students catch rats and bring it over to the school. You know, they actually cut the tail of rats and made a kind of socks for the sharp, you know, needles. And they exported. We were just started. We just started just like that. Just like that, nothing else, nothing miraculous kind of things. So the major policies and incentives provided by Korean government is that how actually they're going to make the Korean products, even if it's a highly primitive, rudimentary, and the labor-intensive products, competitive in the national markets. Usually those products are mostly exported by many other poor countries too. So the price competitiveness is extremely important. But one aspect of a developing country is that usually your currency is highly overvalued. Okay? That is a very common phenomenon of developing countries, poor developing countries. And quite often, they are adopting multiple exchange rate system. Okay? Exchange rate system applies to the exporters versus the importers and the travelers and the many different kinds of things. So Korean government, in order to make a Korean export competitive, they said, we are going to make our prices right. You can make a realistic kind of price adjustment. So that in 1961, there was a unified, they introduced unified exchange rate system. Exporters, importers, they know what exchange rate they actually will be applicable with. They know it. And also Korean currency has been devalued by 50% in 1964. Precisely January 17, I was born here. Okay, born in Korea. Okay? And also they have provided many different types of concessions in terms of a tax. Okay? So first of all, free import of materials and the machineries and equipment if they are going to be used for export manufacturing. Whether the company was big or small, doesn't matter. As long as they are in export business, they are allowed to freely import, but subject to product should be exported. And also in 1967, they have introduced negative import system. That particular system has been modified and upgraded many, many times throughout, you know, over the next decades. But they have first introduced negative import list system. You know this one? They actually list certain types of product. Other than this one, you can import anything. this is fantastic for the importers and also exporters too. And if you are doing the kind of a business, your kind of a tax concession in terms of rapid sort of depreciation, that is called generous waste allowance, has been also introduced if you are in the export business. Oh, I think it has been repeated twice. Okay. But one other interesting aspect is that now, in addition to the pecuniary side of tax, you know, concessions and incentives, the president has also used so-called non-pecuniary incentives too. This is really interesting. I have never come across in other countries, because my other second discipline is economic development too, in addition to international economics. The president convened export meeting with little or relatively large firms every month. So it's called the export meeting, convened by Your Excellency, Mr. President himself. And at that particular meeting, he was asking Chairman Zhang, okay, do you have any problem in exporting? Or Chairman Kim, do you have any problem, any issues which actually hinders you from meeting the export targets? What is it I can do to resolve those hindrances? I can get rid of it. He actually listened to the entrepreneurs, business people, and then he asked, Chairman Zhang, next month he exported 3 million. So this month, would you be able to export 4 million? And something like that. So set export target. Carrot has come in return for kind of a stick, but not as strong as the policy will have been, which will have been implemented in the 1970s. So president was monitoring what issues actually unresolved and whether companies are able to meet the export targets. In addition to the monthly meeting, he highly publicized those exporters in the news media, televisions and radios. Unlike many other countries, Korea still has so-called Export Day, which actually happens on November 30th, last day of the month, November, and they're actually rewarding the firms and the enterprises which have achieved 5 million exports, 10 million exports, 100 million export, 1 billion export, something like that. The president or the minister of industry, trade and commerce, he is actually giving out those, you know, certificates and the prizes and something like that. I think if you are in this kind of a business, you could be highly motivated. Your president is listening to you. And you are also socially highly recognized by media and also by general public. So everybody is actually supporting what you are doing, or indirectly, it is a supported, kind of supportive mechanism for the president, I guess. But I'm not coming into the political arena, okay? And one other thing happened in the 1960s was is a president's very brave decision to normalize diplomatic relationship with Korea's former colonial ruler, Japan, in 1965. Okay? There was a great demonstrations by students and the leaders of the society, NGOs, political parties, but government and the president actually took and showed his leadership and signed diplomatic relationship with Japan. In return for, there is actually a reason behind the president's decision to establish diplomatic relationship with the former ruler was that in return for normalizing relationship, Japan has a guarantee certain amount of foreign capitals, which was in desperate need for Korea's economy. And also Japan has a promise that certain types of export Korean product will have a market in Japan. So export market was created. Okay? And also back then in the 60s, Japan was considered to be advanced in technology than Korea. So Japan was a, has a promise to transfer certain types of technology to Korea. Okay? So the Japan has become source of a foreign capital and has a provider, has become an export market as well as source of advanced technology. Okay? So Korean economy has been growing pretty well, as you are seeing here. I think on average it was growing almost 10% per annum. Okay? From 1962 to 1971. Okay, so I will quickly jumping to the next stage. In the 1960s, as I said before, Korean economic development strategy was based upon exporting highly labor-intensive manufacturing product, because that was where the Korea has comparative advantage. If you have studied international economics, there are absolute advantage and the comparative advantage, right? So the comparative advantage means you have a minimum opportunity cost. To be simply speaking. Okay? But after the successful economic expansion, which was accompanied by almost 10% on average, Korea has come into the early 1970s. The Korean economic trade policy has changed into some kind, instead of just merely cultivating comparative advantage, they want to create comparative advantage, which is actually against kind of economics principle. In economics principle, you are not able to create your own comparative advantage, because a comparative advantage is actually based upon what it was given at that particular time. Even though the past actually shows the dynamics of a comparative advantage, but Korean government was so brave to create, they tried to move in advance of the time. Okay? So at the beginning of 1972, that was also beginning of the third five-year economic development plan, which has lasted until 1976, and also of the fourth one, okay, 1977 to 1981. Okay. The Korea wanted to create comparative advantages in heavy and chemical industries by intervening quite seriously in that particular creating comparative advantage process. The six heavy and chemical industry are also known to be strategic industries. Okay? As you are seeing here, iron and steel, non-ferrous metal, and the shipbuilding industry, petrochemical, machinery and electrical. Those are six heavy and chemical industries are called strategic industries, but in terms of its idiosyncrasy, they are also highly capital-intensive industries and also technology-intensive industries, as well as extremely energy-intensive industries. You are not talking to me, are you? Oh, merci beaucoup. Okay. There was actually a reason behind such a changing over from the utilizing or the capitalizing comparative advantage to creating comparative advantage. I will just quickly tell you the background. The Korea was losing its comparative advantage in labor-intensive manufacturing products. So they need to upgrade their industrial structure as well as export structures. The reason was simply, usually when the economy, especially in the export sector, was expanding very rapidly, wages is rising concurrently too. It's at almost a pronounced kind of a matchup. Okay? So you are losing kind of a comparative advantage in the labor-intensive product. That's a natural outcome of a successful economic expansion. And in addition to Korea and also Taiwan, Hong Kong and Singapore, they were used to be called as Asian Tigers or Asian Knees, the newly industrializing economies. Okay? Asian Knees or Asian Four Tigers. Okay? So they actually look at Korea and also three other Asian nations. They could do it. Even Korea, the poorest country in the early 1960s, she was able to grow such rapidly by exporting. Why can't our ASEAN countries do the same thing? Let's do it. So kind of a catching up was taking place. And at the same time, in the advanced, developed countries, there was increasing high levels of trade barriers imposed upon exports coming from, the products coming from, those Asian needs. So we cannot just sustain the same level of export expansion which actually propelled Korea's economic success. So we need to switch over to other types of manufacturing. That's why they decided to choose those six heavy and chemical industries. And in addition to the economic reasons, there was also non-economic reasons. The late 1960s, precisely 1969, I think somewhere in April, I cannot remember. But the then president of the United States, Richard Nixon, has declared the so-called doctrine, which says we need to Koreanize Korean security. After the Korean War, they actually stationed United States military troops on the Korean Peninsula to protect Korea against possible invasion by North Korea and China and the Soviet Russia back then. But he said it. We need to leave it to Korean people for their security. Why the U.S. people has to care about it? So it's called Koreanization of Korean security, under the Nixon doctrines. And as we know, that you know, 1975, Vietnam has a fall under. Okay? I think which was the only war U.S. has been so severely involved, but lost. First time in their history, I guess. That's what I read it from. Okay. So policies, the main policies used by the Korean government in creating comparative advantage was simply speaking, it's carrots and the sticks. So carrot is sweet, but stick is hard, isn't it? Okay. So the carrots first, government subsidies and the tax concessions. Okay. They provide all types of preference. The preferential loans and the policy loans with which they become almost a negative interest rate, you know. And they have actually allowed those industry in the heavy and the companies or enterprises and firms in the heavy and chemical industries, you need a foreign capital, okay, government will guarantee for the repayment. So go for it. Almost a free access to, okay, the foreign capitals. But at the same time, the government said it, okay, your production will be protected against any types of import. Ooh, this is a kind of something like eating piece of a cake, right? So easy. You are guaranteed to the money, foreign capital, equipment, and also your market is protected. So we call it, in the 70s, the policies actually this particular time period, include the policies, it's a second stage of Korea's import substitutions. Do I have to go a little faster or not? Okay. So Korean economy, thanks to this particular one. Oh, okay. Sticks, I need to say, mention too. You need to export quite a fair bit. Okay. So they actually create a so-called company called General Trading Company, in the Japanese term Shogo, Shosa. It's a general trading company. The Samsung, I think your mobile phone manufacturer, my mobile phone manufacturer, Samsung, was the first general trading company in 1975, created by, or created in Korea. And they have requested those general trading companies, in order for you to be able to be, to export large amount of manufacturing or the products to overseas, you need to be big. So big is better. So if you are qualified as a general trading company, you have access to all of those carrots provided by government. But qualification was a little hard. So for example, in order for you to be qualified as a general trading company in Korea, okay, in 1975, you are supposed to be able to export $50 million or more. That bar has been raised up to over $300 million in 4 years later. Wow, you need to really, really expand, grow very, very quickly. So general trading companies, they actually busy making or meeting up these export bars so that they knew they can enjoy as many kinds of benefits associated or provided by the government. Because government has preferred large firms, large general trading companies, so naturally small and medium-sized enterprises were discriminated because they're unable to export that much. $300 million, even this figure is really big nowadays, even nowadays. So thanks to this particular policies creating competitive advantage, Korea was able to grow 9% on average for that particular 10-year period. Not too bad, right? But we know in 1970s, there was something horrible happened in the international resource market. First, oil price shock happened in the later part of 1973, exceeded over to 1974. Oil price has been doubled. In the later part of 1978 to 1979, oil price has quadrupled. But we didn't have any oils. How can you actually sustain such six strategic industries? As I said before, those industries are highly energy-intensive industries. How can you actually sustain it? So, Korean government was responding, okay? Such that in the 1980s, Korean economy has changed into the taking form of liberalization and at the same time globalization. So the era of liberalization and globalization. Beginning with 6 and 7 five-year economic development plans. But these particular types, during this particular time period, instead of just a mere five-year economic development plan, it actually changed its name to five-year economic and a social development plans. So they start actually looking at social society. Instead of just a mere expansion-based growth perspective, they're looking at stability and the equity, social welfare, the openness, competitions, and that kind of issues. Okay? Well, luckily, as you're looking at the bottom, Korean economy was able to grow over 10% per annum this particular time period. Background, there are internal pressures arising from the sectoral imbalance between the heavy and chemical industries and other industries, and also large firm versus small firms, and the inefficiency associated with the capacity utilization and so forth. And unfortunately, our president has been assassinated by his right-hand man in 1979. And Korea, I don't know what your staple food, grain actually is here in Georgia, but in Korea, our main staple food is actually based on rice. Without rice, we cannot actually survive. This is a lie nowadays, but without rice, we cannot actually live. So rice is a staple food, but somehow something really bad happened, bad harvest happened. In Korea, only just one crop. One, the harvesting of rice, planting something like early May and goes over to and start harvesting from October and November and something like that. We had a frost somewhere in the middle of August. So the rice production has just plummeted. Okay? And also, as I said before, there was other aspect coming from international oil prices in the 1970s. Okay? And the external side, that was coming from high international interest rate. Do you know that this is almost the beginning of so-called the Reaganomics? Okay? Mr. Ronald Reagan's economic policy was a high interest rate, making US dollar stronger. So every country in the world that followed suit. But Korea needed money from overseas. So that higher interest rate means basically you have to pay a lot back, isn't it? So creating pressure on the Korean economies. And also because of that, and the high oil prices and so forth, global economy was slowing down too. Okay. So this particular, how much time do I have? I have to check. Okay. I will go for roughly 20-something more minutes, okay? About 10 minutes, okay. So general policy stance was basically, as we did the correct prices right, okay, kind of things. They made the policy regime was to correct excess and the imbalances, okay? Instead of just the export earnings to enhance international competitiveness. And they tried to give more initiative to private side instead of just the government leading in every corner of society and economies. And in terms of liberalization, they actually continued import liberalization. This is one interesting aspect. In the 80s, they said it, without any pressure coming from, you know, GATT or other international organizations, government itself has pre-announced in 1983, Korea's import liberalization will be 84%. By 1986, it will be 86%. In 1987, it will be 93%, and something like that. They have taken unilateral the import liberalization effort. If you are doing your business in other countries, that's really good, isn't it? You have a transparency coming from the Korean government. They were not sure whether tariff will be or import will be liberalized, but the Korean government pre-announced this product will be liberalized. So unilateral decisions. And the government has actually sold lots of their shares, banks, okay, privatized banking, and also they have actually taken initiative of privatizing interest rate in the later part of the 1980s. And also they have introduced negative system of inward foreign direct investment. I know that Georgia has a very free the foreign direct investment policy regimes now. But back in Korea, it was the case, okay, in the 1984. And not only the economic side of liberalization, and also there was a great turnaround in the political arena too. In 1987, June 29, okay, that was the then presidential candidate of the incumbent president John Doohan, who has come into his office by military coup in 1980. He was just about to hand over his presidency to the next person, and the same graduate from classmate of Korea's military academy. And the candidate, Mr. Noh Tae-woo, announced that there will be free elections. And the political side will be freed, liberalized. And after that June 29th, because declaration made June 29th, so we call it June 29th, declaration of a democratization, a large number of industrial disputes actually has taken place. I didn't have actually the statistic here. In 1987 alone, there were over 3,000 something industrial disputes reported to Korean Ministry of Labor. That means about 10 labor disputes every day, okay, kind of things. But luckily, Korea was able to grow very, very rapidly, especially in the mid-1980s. Oh, The reason we said it's the quest for globalization is if you are doing business with the people, when they are taking the streets and the industrial sabotage, industrial dispute, and the demand for higher wages, better working conditions, if you are the owner of a firm, what would you do? Two choices. You shut down your business. Au revoir, sayonara. Okay? Or number two, if you are truly the entrepreneur, okay, I will try to find my business opportunities in other countries. So they actually start looking at countries in Southeast Asia. So massive foreign direct investment outflow has taken place from this particular time period. That's why we call it this particular period as the quest for globalization. The reason behind this very rapid economic growth is got to do with the three blessings. I will skip this part. Okay. Korean economy has been cruising, so to speak, until it has come across the Asian financial crisis in the later part of the 1990s, okay, 1997. Oh, I didn't delete this one. It's not 19,912, okay, it was 1,992, okay, get to 1996. They actually announced the 8th Five-Year Economic Development Plan, okay, and the Korean economy was growing fairly well at the year on average, 7.2%, okay, annually. But somehow Korean economy's international competitiveness was getting weaker because of a fast rising the wages. Nominal wage was expanding almost 20%, close to 20% on average. Real economic real wages was expanding by 13% per annum. Currency has been revalued. The value of a currency has gone up, so losing international competitiveness. Okay? And also, Korean economy was slowing down and the switch over, especially after the Seoul Olympics in 1988. And instead of export-based economic expansion, it has actually switched over to the consumption-based economies, okay? Economic growth. Somehow the current account has turned in deficit, and somehow the Korean economy, Korean government, they wanted to join, they wanted to be called League of Their Own, OECD member country. One precondition to becoming OECD as a member country, they had a startup observer, OECD observer country status. One condition was Korea needs to liberalize its capital account. So with the liberalization capital account, hot money flow into Korea, and that money actually went outside Southeast Asia, Thailand, Indonesia, Malaysia, and then so forth. So when the actually first financial Asian financial crisis took place in Thailand, Japanese side, the Korean side, and they start actually collapsing. Spread over to Indonesia, and it has a great contagion effect to Malaysia, Taiwan, and to Korea. So Korea has collapsed in 1987, November. So the Korean economy has contracted by over 5%. It has been growing over 7%, close to 10% in previous decades. But somehow it has contracted quite substantially. Okay? Korean currency, the value of a Korean currency has plummeted by 40% in 1998 relative to the value of 1997. Unemployment rate has gone up to the ceiling to 7%. Oh, 7% doesn't sound that high. Even I think Georgia nowadays you have about 13% unemployment rate. Yeah. But Korea's 7% unemployment rate was unimaginable because in the previous year, unemployment rate was only just 2.6%, something like that. Okay? So reform has taken place in all parts of the Korea. Public sector, private sector, but initiated by Korean government. So Korean government led reforms, okay? And also they actually opened Korea for international foreign direct investment. So nowadays, Korean foreign direct investment is called to be one of the most liberalized foreign direct investment regime in the world. Okay? Back to normal, Korea. Okay? Now, after Korean financial economic crisis caused by the Asian financial crisis, okay, Korea actually stopped announcing its 5-year economic development plan. They didn't announce anything. That whichever president comes into the regime, and they announce certain new forms of policies. But in terms of international trade policy, the Korean government was looking at regional trading agreement, especially headed by free trade agreement. Well, if you are not becoming a member of a regional trading agreement, you are losing markets, simply speaking. So Korean economy has to be propelled by the overseas markets. So they need to engage themselves in negotiating free trading agreement. Okay? Well, not just by Korea, globally, with the beginning of a WTO, regional trading agreement, and especially free trade agreement has expanded very rapidly. Okay? So Korea had to join that particular trend, global trend too. So that as recently as in 2015, Korea has 11 free trade agreements in force and the 5 free trade agreements that have been signed and are ready to be implemented very soon, including with the debt of China. So that is actually a policy. Okay. Well, there is actually a reason that because the Korea has engaged in simultaneous numerous free trade agreements at the same time, so different free trade agreement has created different kind of rules for the tax tariff concessions. We call it that's a spaghetti ball effect. It's coined by Jagdish Bhagwati of Columbia University. So it's instead of getting rid of the burdens coming from the tariff, actually create more cost coming from administration side to meet the standard and the rules. So they need to get rid of it. And also in the 1990s and also 2000s, Asia is considered to be main hub of global supply chains. So the global supply chain is you actually dissect a bit of your production process, actually posting into different regions and the countries based upon their own comparative advantages. So freer trade environment is actually better for the companies. The company has demanded for that. Okay? And also the other side of the globe, you have EU, okay? And on the North American side, NAFTA, on the South American side, Mercosur is arising. And one added advantage of becoming member to bigger free trade agreement is that you have a kind of a pseudo guarantees for national security because you are member countries. So instead of engaging in simultaneous free trade agreement, Korea start looking at mega free trade agreement. So-called RCEP, Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnerships, surrounding ASEAN 10 countries, and Japan, Korea, China, and Australia, New Zealand, and so forth. And recently we heard about the TPP, Trans-Pacific Partnership, has been actually agreed upon, right? So something like that. So we actually look at, we need to become that part. Then we can actually have a level playing field. That was actually a strategy. I think that Georgia has signed with the EU, right? Deep and comprehensive economic development. So it is ready to be implemented, okay? So I will skip this part. So actually I had a look at Korea and Georgia now. I'll finish in 5 minutes. Okay. You are looking at the statistics, but I didn't see much difference between Korea now and Georgia now. But you are in the beginning of a development stages. That means you are a lot better positioned than anybody else. This statistic is actually coming from the CIA, the World Factor Books. I think some of our concerns is that you are importing a lot more than exporting. I think your official exchange rate, I think a prime lending rate is about 13.6%. In Korea, it's about 4.7%. What is happening to the lending side? I was told you have a number of commercial banks operating. Something is there. Because the banks are charging a lot, that means you are not saving enough. Simply speaking, you are not saving enough. The national savings rate is less than 16%. Korea, almost 40%. Okay? Something like that. Okay? I don't know, maybe one thorny issue is coming from in terms of a relationship with the Soviet, Russia, I guess. Okay? So, Korea has established diplomatic ties with Georgia in December 14, 1992, and the Korean embassy was opened about 2 months ago. I wonder why it took such a long time for Korea to establish its mission here. Okay? And Korea's bilateral trade volume with Georgia is only just $164 million. It's almost nothing to the size of Korea's overall trade, surpassing $1 trillion. Export, $144 million. And imports from Georgia is only just a mere $20 million. Okay? And Korea's foreign investment here, I thought it has the most liberal foreign direct investment regime in, if not in the whole entire world, at least in this part of Eurasia. But why don't you invest enough? Okay? This is actually the major items that Korea is exporting, motor cars and this sort of things. Okay? Your import, okay? Our import from Georgia, our friend, is predominantly kind of textile, basically. And some of aluminum waste and scraps, okay? And also some part of the oil there, okay? Natural resource part of, and also labor intensive, the garment or textile industries. I think you are smart enough to upgrade your, the export structures, not just merely rely on your natural resources or something like that. So this actually shows Korea's investment distribution in terms of industry distribution for the entire, the amount of $9.9 million, okay? Okay. But I thought about it, that both countries, well, we are so far apart, isn't it? Okay, I think over 4,000 miles between Korea and Georgia. I think our flying, if you have a direct flight, maybe it will take 6, 7, 8 hours, I guess, something like that. Wow. But can we become partners in this multilateral free trade agreement regimes? I think you've been approved, or you have signed as associate member to EU, and also I think that has been done in the last year. Yeah, sooner or later, you may become a member to EU, okay? Accession is possible. And the free trade agreement with the European Union is also possible. I think sooner or later, with the US, perhaps, most likely, and more promising way is to looking at the Eurasia. So creating bigger part of trading blocks, to which and in which Korea will be utterly interested, okay? But as we had a look at it, the statistics, why such a lackluster relationship, trade investment between Korea and Georgia? Why? Because my personal thought is we don't know it with each other. You know, when I actually landed, as I said, I flew in Friday evening. I thought I have a little bit of understanding of Central Asia, Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, Turkmenistan, Kyrgyzstan. So Georgia could be one of countries similar.
One of Aziastan.
You know? Or maybe similar to Turkey or something. But I realized your language has been distinctively different from other language families. Wow. I was really surprised. You're all different. Your climate is much, you know, friendlier than other countries in Central Asia and the Far East. How much do you know about Korea except Gangnam style? Okay? So we need to improve our mutual understanding. Once there is a, you know, improve or enhance the mutual understanding between the two countries, I think there is a greater amount of trade, business opportunities, and investment opportunities. I think that's why His Excellency, Mr. Kim, the ambassador of Korea to the Georgia, he actually was a president himself. Then who can help improve mutual understanding? You. The person, the people sitting at this particular lecture and the previous one, you are the one. If you are moving around the globe, okay, particularly to Korea, okay, your understanding of a Korean people, Korean culture, Korean society, and you're graduating, and your companies will be interested in doing business with Korea. You are the one, no one else but you. And your dad, she's going to help you to travel to Korea. I'm sure about that. I think she's going to make a proposal to the government of Georgia to make some kind of a schemes under which young people that can travel, study. I had the project initiated by EU called EU-ICI project, under which each year, about 80 European students actually came over to Korea for 5 years. For 5 years. And a similar number of Korean students, they actually went over to the European side. Same number, switched over. They are doing really great after that kind of a project. I look forward to similar kind of a scheme to be implemented between Korea and Georgia. And the main beneficiary will be you. No one else but you. I will welcome all of you to Korea. Thank you very much. I know I have taken a little bit longer than usual, but if you have any question, I'm quite happy to. Yes. I think there are some people who would like to.
Sorry?
No, the microphone is there.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. So, who's the first one? Well, actually, I would like to use my opportunity as a moderator and ask you one of the questions. Looking at the economical. Yeah.
Oh my God, the moderator has to come at the last.
No, should I come first? So, first question. Do you think that Georgia has economic potential to at least reach the level of Korea in like 60 years?
Do you want me to say
yes
to that?
No. Actually, I want to say your
no.
true opinion. Why?
You will be even bigger.
What's that?
You know, the reason that I'm actually saying that one is that you are actually located in the middle of the corridor connecting Eastern European countries and the West Asia. You are located in the corridor. Right? So I'm actually looking at the country like, in terms of population size, as almost the same as yours, Hong Kong and Singapore, and in terms of territorial size, much smaller, yeah, those two. So they are much richer than Korea. Georgia can be even richer than Korea in 60 years. I believe, I trust, because of you. young people. Truly. You know, those countries, Singapore was not as good as nowadays. They have GDP per capita like almost $50,000 US, but they were very poor too. The Singapore was very poor too. They educated young people. They actually enabled the young people to move around. And government, they were which was committed to economic development, making Singapore rich and grow. You can do it.
Thank you. So now the audience.
안녕하세요.
안녕하세요.
First of all, thank you for the interesting lecture. So you mentioned that Georgia and Korea have growing trade relationship. So as a student who intends to study Korean and its culture, I want to know which field exactly in Georgia is appealing, for example, for a Korean investor.
So. Korean investor. Okay.
Thank you. 감사합니다.
감사합니다. As I said, because of geographical location of Georgia, I think one thing that you can do is about logistics side. Number one is a logistics side. Because you are linking, you are location in the linkage, in the middle of linking Europe and Asia. You know, nowadays even China and Korea, Japan, you are actually creating sort of an Asian highway linking from Japan, Korea, China, coming down to Central Asia. The passage will go through this country and then Turkey. So you are right in the middle of that logistics hub. Okay, that's one thing that I can believe. And another one, the Korea is really doing well, is like a communication side, telecommunication side. And number three, I believe that I don't have exact details in about Georgia, but I think you might have too many commercial banks.
Too many?
Yeah, too many, I guess. You need to have a slightly bigger banks like Hong Kong Shanghai Bank. Okay? So I think the other one is something that I can give you a tip is like tourism industry is extremely important matters because I try to find the exact statistics of how many Koreans actually visited Georgia more recently, but Georgia has become emerged as a very popular tourist destination for Korean people. They're coming over. They enjoy wine, okay? Really. So, as I said, I have traveled down to the just off the Tbilisi over the last couple of days. You have a great historical monument, which can turn into highly sustainable tourist attractions, I guess. So, why not?
Hello. First of all, I want to say that I'm interested in Korean history, culture, and traditions very much, and I really like it. And I first got interested into history when I read a documentary writing about the comfort women, so-called comfort women of Korea, of Japanese military service. So I want to ask you, how could Korean people, you as a South Korean, how can you answer me? How could Korean people remain so culturally responsible for their heritage? How could they be so conservative still nowadays? Because they are very impressive for me, and I really appreciate them as a very very respectful respectful ethnicity.
For that particular group of people are you referring to, or just the whole Korean people?
I mean South Korean citizens.
Ah, okay. I thought that I was paying more attention to the comfort women's side. But Korea is considered to be highly homogeneous countries. Okay? As you know, that highly homogeneous means because of a unification since the mid-7th century. Okay? So we had a distinctively one, for example, the religion, Buddhism, coming from, I think, somewhere in the BC, 307 something before Christ era, actually, and then flowing down to the early 20th centuries. So one, religion is there, and also somehow we have also the Confucianism, which have been introduced even the before Christ century, Christ era from China, and that has actually turned into highly Koreanized. We call it neo-Confucianism, okay, unlike very pragmatic Confucianism of China and Japan. So we have a very distinctive. So we've been living under such a homogeneous kind of a culture throughout the long time period. I think that is one identity, one method of keeping Korean identity. But nowadays, more recently, Korean government is actually publicizing, trace the origin of Korean culture to Korean general public. So Korean diplomacy, public diplomacy is taking place not only just outside Korea, but also it is happening within Korea in terms of cultural promotions. So from that angle, I think even the comfort woman is actually embraced into because of the economic, the affluence that has allowed to, bring them into our society. So they are considered to be senior citizens. Prior to, they are Koreans, they are senior citizens in Korea. Prior to, they were comfort women. So we are actually respecting, we are showing our respect to Korean citizens, Korean senior citizens by seniority standard because we are Koreans. Okay?
So, last two questions. Sapo?
Yeah, she's in jade color. Yeah, here.
Hello. First of all, thank you for the interesting lecture. My question is about modern economy more. It's latest news. It's about China, Korea, Japan trade summit that is happening, I think, this week. Mm-hmm. And they're going to talk about pending free trade agreement. Mm-hmm. And I would like your opinion about how can this affect South Korea, considering the U.S.-led Trans-Pacific partnership where Korea wants to be part of, and considering that U.S. and China are competitive in the Asia region. Mm. Thank you.
Yeah, I know that the summit meeting will take place among the three countries from China, Korea, and Japan. I think one of the reasons why Korea-Japan free trade agreement didn't come into an agreement was because our industrial structure overlaps with that of Japan. So we consider that we may lose some of our industry to the Japanese industries. If we are actually opening up the Korean borders to China, we thought we may lose certain industries to the Chinese industries. But we actually signed with China. I think the Chinese government has the parliament, the People's Congress has approved. And this is this agreement, Korea-China Free Trade Agreement, is actually on the desk of Korean National Parliament. It will be approved by the parliament pretty soon. I'm expecting by the end of this year, or maybe early next year, Korea-China Free Trade Agreement will come into effect. That being said, it's most likely that Japan and also Korea will start kicking off more seriously about the free trade agreement. So trilateral free trade agreement, maybe even extending over to, as I said, the RCEP will be agreed upon more quickly. And Korea is piling for its membership to the TPP. So I think that issue will be, I'm expecting, discussed at some stage, in addition to the comfort women issue with Japan. Yes.
Thank you. So the last but not least.
Hello, thank you again for the interesting lecture. Where my question is about kind of political and economic question. If South and North Korea unites, like what will happen to the South Korean economy? Because like how I see it is that South Korea will need to spend lots of money to help Southern integration into like, to help the integration of cultures and traditions. Mm-hmm. So like, how do you see what will happen? Like, as Professor Kim already mentioned, it will help, it will help to develop Korea's economic, but first few years, how it's gonna be? Like, will it, how it will affect South Korea's economic? Thank you.
Okay, I think somehow it's partly related with what Professor Kim has lectured about. I think, he has mentioned that particular one. But from the economics perspective, as we understand it, when the East and West Germany, when they actually united, I think the cost of unification was unsurmountable. I think still, in a sense, West Germany is still suffering from the legacy of those unification. I think a similar kind of impact may happen to the Korea's unification. Then, I think it's almost a foreseeable outcome. So, given that to Korea to be united in pretty soon, sometime pretty immediate near future, what could be the best way that we can take the, I'm not a political scientist, but I'm as an economist, if I make a kind of a suggestion. And this is also highly got to do with the reason why Korea has a Kaesong industrial complex on the North Korean soil. I believe that the very first stage of unification of the Korean Peninsula is becoming or making two economies as one, like arranging almost a free trade agreement kind of, or the comprehensive economic partnership, which actually we have some kind of the precedence of this particular case between the country called Australia and New Zealand. They have signed a comprehensive economic partnership in 1985, so people, they can actually travel freely. The export import is a free tariff, but it's a two sovereign states. So I think that's the possible region down the track, okay? Possible the outcomes down the track. Rather than immediate political unification, I would like to foresee, I'd like to say that economic integration comes first, and then social integration in terms of people's mobility, and then political unification. So if we're looking at the entire kind of unification, I think it might take a generation or two. But I think as starting with the economic integration could be maybe the first step to take in order to reduce that the economic cost. I think it was enough for me to answer to all the questions. Okay.
So thank you very much. I would also like to thank Professors Mikaburiza and Professor Jean, because without you, I don't think this lecture would be possible. And I'd like to thank the Korean Foundation, who's sitting right somewhere in the back. Thank you very much. So, on this.
Thank you very much.